we as professionals in the internet space, could we seriously argue that there are no circumstances ever that this could be an issue? We can't.
Okay.
So I think the counter data that really we are talking about is whether any reasonable person would actually suggest that this is something that threats to security are impossible using or abusing the internet. I don't think anybody can argue that. In fact, if you look at what has happened with Snowden, you can look at it the other way around and say that, well, people genuinely believe that there are security implications of what is going on in the internet.
The government looks at it from that perspective. I remember during my tenure in the ministry, there was a Bangalore episode happened there, the exodus of the northeastern people going. Then at that time, I was called to the Home Ministry that JS talks me. And then Nixie, you know, how can you shut down the internet that particular area? I said, look, it is not done like that. Because there's IP addresses are there, ISPs are there, how many users are there. You cannot shut down just like that, like you do in the physical world. So the perspective that point of time, maybe about 8-10 years back, was much. But today I believe the technology is enabling you to see that in a very focused way, how are you going to do this kind of thing? One, and the second point is, with the kind of Facebook and other kind of thing where, you know, today I read that in the Facebook, they are going to the you know, some kind of objectionable videos if they can shut down within their system. So that's why, you know, that we have to find some kind of solution in this kind of space where, you know, how do we curb those kind of objectionable, you know, stories and the WhatsApp and all those kind of things, instead of shutting down the entire system in particular area. And if there is a way forward in this kind of thing, otherwise, you know, the entire area has to be shut down.
So primarily, there are two things we get. One is the formal request for certain URLs to be blocked. So as per our license condition, we have no choice but to act on that. On certain other times, for example, when the Bombay riots happened, that information was emanating from Muzaffarnagar, and it happened to be our IP, our customer. So we were then cajoled in the back end that come what may, don't stop his service.
Okay.
And they put the specific equipment for that particular customer to tap. So our cooperation was sought, and we were to ask to cooperate, and in no manner, and eventually they did catch the person live while sending it mail, and we got a letter thanking us for support. Then ISP can do it. At this moment, ISP has got between two swords. One is, if we decide on our own, we are questioned by the same government. If we don't do it, we are questioned. If we do it, also we are questioned. So at this moment, that code of conduct freedom, which newspaper industry has evolved, such code of conduct, if it is there, probably it may help. The first thing is, what is the need for such shutdown? That question, if you could seek from others.
Okay.
As well.
I would really, you know, put that question for, you know, open. Is there a consensus that there should be no shutdown?
Can we have a show of hands? Sit this mic.
What is the question?
How many people think that there should be absolutely no internet shutdown anywhere in the country? Okay. I don't think we are voting here, but the majority of the House feels that there should be no internet shutdowns.
Government, when it has to look after the interest of even 1%, you know, it has to take into account that how does you protect the life of 1%? Not, it's not a question of protecting the life of majority. And you say, okay, minority, we don't take. You have to take a view so that not a single life is lost, or not a single property is lost, or not a single person's right is hampered. Then a view possibly is.
In fact, that's the point that I was raising initially, that, you know, if even one life is saved, how do you put a value on that? is the question. But we're looking to see whether there are there alternatives available.
Absolutely.
And therefore, we're looking for challenges.
And if there are alternatives, I think that's a very good question. The question is not really whether the internet should be shut down or not. The question is, are there better ways available by which you can achieve the same result without having to, you know, resort to a more across-the-board painting of the brush, you know, or taking a very broad-based approach? That is a very good question to look at, deliberate, and come with solution. When I was collector, which is more than 25 years back now, so, you know, things, internet did not exist. And so we never had to, you know, I as DM never had the issue posed before me that, you know, to prevent this situation, one of the things you need to do is to block internet, you know. So, you know, we really need, if you want the law enforcement view of it, I think we must have those stakeholders come and say, look, I had this situation, and therefore I had to do this, you know. And that view would be the other side of the view. I honestly don't represent that view.
But sir, that time there were telephone services were there. But had this situation there,
while internet was not there, that time back, there were telephone service. Was there a situation where...
telephone is, you know, there's no comparison between telephone. You can't send a message on telephone and reaches 1 million people.
Just before
there
you...
There's no way. I mean, the whole paradigm change of internet vis-a-vis any other technology in the past is simply this, you know. Today, on one shot, you can instantaneously, you can reach large number of people. And anyone can reach, you know, with practically zero cost. Whereas there was previously, either in the physical or technological domain, there was no way by which it was possible to be able to reach out to that many large number of people instantaneously at practically zero cost. So if I, you know, to mobilize big rallies which political parties could do, they had to spend a huge amount of effort. Today, to mobilize a large number of people, it may just need a SMS campaign or a WhatsApp campaign, you know, and you can do it. It's a totally different paradigm today.
So I don't speak for law enforcement, but in conversations I have had with several people, is the response we usually get is, if you do a backward analysis of communal incidents in the last few months or years, there are two things that stand out. One is loudspeakers around religious establishments, and the second is WhatsApp messages, which unverified information, which leads to mobs coming together. And usually law enforcement will say, what do I do in a situation where people are flooding WhatsApp with, you know, a minor incident of a collision on the road between two people becomes a communal incident, saying X community hit by community, and people are organized such. And that is usually the response, like, law enforcement will give you, is saying, what am I supposed to do? How do I deal with this information going out? People are coming out on the streets. We shut the internet down.
The other aspect is that in some ways, this internet shutdown reaction has been a knee-jerk reaction, because many police forces also didn't understand how quickly technology can impact whatever they're supposed to do. So traditional policing methods were sort of, A, because of political interference and because of vested interests, policing has also become highly politicized in some ways, and we know the state of police reforms in this country. So as a result, especially during communal problems, etc., police has not been able to intervene as quickly and as fast as they would like to. And therefore, traditional policing methods, which would ensure that you use the danda when you need to use it, was not really working out. And this was seen particularly in during the Muzaffarnagar riots. The other problem that the police also faced, and this is something I know because my friend was the IGSTF when they were handling this, and he made a presentation to the DGP's conference three years ago, which is the highest body of police chiefs, where it was discovered that some of the videos which were being used to inflame passions were actually coming from Pakistan. And in fact, one particular video was a video which had come from Pakistan, which had created a major problem and was being shared on various peer-to-peer sharing networks to ensure that more and more people get agitated. And they had no idea how to, A, go for IP addresses to find out who has uploaded this, because this video had been uploaded on Facebook, and they were trying to contact Facebook, and Facebook wasn't helping. They were trying to also track down the IP. They asked for data from American companies and the American government, but by the time... also the process is the process of getting information from America, where most of these companies reside. One is the MLAT process, and the other is through emergency means. Both of them are
very long.
And secondly, for countries like the US, which of course MLAT is now trying to address, they don't understand what is a communal flare-up, because culturally they are not used to something like this. So they didn't understand the urgency of what is going on, and therefore this led to a whole lot of problems for the police from a law enforcement perspective. I can share some more as discussions continue.
My point actually was that the if you don't use blunt tools, you actually will have to increase surveillance, which was mentioned. And that is something that is kind of unacceptable to me, because the potential for misuse of surveillance, individual surveillance, is far greater than a blunt tool, which is then applied to the whole population and is kind of the effect is spread, and the governments are also hesitant to use it against everyone.
I have three disparate points to make. One is that I, in principle, don't agree that just because you are lower in the hierarchy, you don't have certain decision-making rights. Man on the spot always has to be given certain rights, you know, because the responsibility is. Therefore, the empowerment also should be at that level. Now, in practical terms, if you're giving an SP of a district 300 armed guards with the power to fire at people, I don't, in principle, believe that the guy doesn't have the power to shut down the internet in that district. You know? So, you have given that guy shoot at site orders, he can issue that order with the signature of the district magistrate. Now you're telling him that he doesn't have the power to shut down internet. That is not a good argument to make. Otherwise, for everything, people have to go upward and upward and upward. And we are trying to create a very dictatorial single person or five people kind of a system, you see. For everything, if you need approval. So local empowerment is necessary. That was my first point. Secondly, I want to, you know, flip around the debate a little bit to figure out if internet, you know, mobile calls, are this becoming alibis for real law enforcement? You know, so if, for example, I have heard cases where people have been kidnapped in UP. First thing that the law enforcement officer does, the inspector who comes to your house, says, "Yaar, iska Facebook account mein kya tha, batao to? Iske calls track karo." Even before they have went and spoken to the school and find out where the guy was, what was he doing at that time when he was kidnapped, did anybody saw it, the neighbor saw it or not. And I know this is becoming a habit increasingly with law enforcement authorities as an alibi, because, you know, all of you, some of you know Rakshit Chandan, he consults with the UP police, and it happens in every instance, he's the first person to be called. Iska Facebook account hack karo, aur iska telephone hack karke batao ki kisse baat kar raha tha. Even before they have spoken to the relatives, you know. And we all know 90% of these cases happen either through relatives or friends. So my fear is that let not internet or mobile calls or this digital medium become an alibi for real, you know, empowered people to enforce real law and real, you know, enforcement at the ground level. So I think these were two fundamental.
You had a third point as well?
Third point, again, I don't want to kind of, you know, deviate, but again, third point was basically a point that, again, I go back to my first principle, that this what is the principle that drives it? You know, if somebody can prove the principle, because it's not new, as I said at the beginning, previously when Dr. Kumar was a district magistrate, calls used to be blocked, right? And the SMS started, now internet has started. So this is a very long practice without any justification in policy. That is what my small submission is, and rationality.
I'll start by a slight and only a very partial disagreement with what Shubho said as far as the devolution of powers is concerned, and the example that he used. That's slightly problematic, because while the SP has the powers to issue shoot at sight orders during a situation, the SP is also trained and is also aware about the consequences when he gives such an order. The impact of such an order can be so high that the SP will think several times before issuing that order, but will not scale the order of shutting down the internet on the same level.
So that's a great point.
So therefore, to compare the two is... Correct. No, but the point that I'm trying to make is that both decisions can be taken by the same man in that sense. But now, which is why I want to bring about a slightly different perspective, which is that today we are in a situation where the essential form of government has not really changed. I mean, we used to read about it in civics and books that Sarkar is Maiba. that my baap concept of the Sarkar has not really changed. And one simple example is that because of the pressures that many of our bureaucrats face, like Dr. Kumar was talking about when he was a district magistrate, and you look at the local SP, they have very limited resources and the challenges of governance are so huge, in many ways they start restricting themselves. The internet is changing a lot of that. It's impacting us in many ways and also forms of governance. Now, let's just think of it this way. We have a minister, the external affairs minister, she regularly responds to people on Twitter. Even in hospital, while she is in hospital waiting for a kidney, somebody is tweeting something and she says, I'm in hospital, etc. Suddenly, the scale of governance begins to look completely different. How many bureaucrats on Twitter or Facebook respond to people? How many police officials on Twitter and Facebook respond to people? And the reason I'm bringing this concept up is that in policing, there was a concept called community policing. And today, when you take that same community online, it's not very different from practicing community policing online as well. And the idea being, if you can start building online communities and start engaging as administrators, as bureaucrats, and we have had some very good examples, especially from the police. For example,
the Bangalore police, for
the
example.
The Bangalore police and even the earlier Mumbai police who would crack so many jokes and he would have these smart one-liners engaging people, etc. They became pretty viral. Today, what is happening is because of the nature of governance, our people who are in positions of power or influence are not responding, are not engaging. The traffic is mostly one way. Now, once they start adopting these mediums, I mean, the point is most people look at social media, they only think of media, they forget the social part of it. So once you bring the two together and start understanding what makes a medium social and start engaging it as you do in the real world, a lot of these issues about, you know, let's shut down the internet, etc., will become irrelevant because you will find alternate and far more meaningful ways to engage with people, ensuring that some of the challenges they are facing are no longer.
Service providers are being given the responsibility of maintaining the privacy, and we follow it very strictly. In one case, somebody asked that tap somebody's email for business or commercial reasons. As service provider, we cannot do that. So whether we can trace the source in 6 phone calls, answer is very much yes. But should service provider be authorized to do so? That is questionable, because service providers are there of all kinds of under pressures and hues. So there must be some, as I said, some code of conduct to be able to say